discussions, start to have a face-to-face understanding on what it means. And so that's why I'm very happy to start this year, as I said, with this series of training. It's four workshops this year that we go through the year. You can look at unitar.org. You can find out all the relevant information. That's what I wanted to stress, why it's so important that we cope with these emerging technologies and their impact, and how they can be actually an instrument for obtaining, in a more efficient way, the sustainable development goals. How these innovation technologies can really improve human life in the most or less advanced countries in our planet. After this, I will really invite Lambert to give us a briefing, a better understanding, because I am really not a techno guy. I was before the millennials, and before the millennials, they were another generation, I am before them. So, for me, having a telephone making a telephone call is already a huge, big impact in my life. So, but for you guys, the millennials, and for those who see us with the gray hair, and those who still have, so this is very appealing. So I am here also to learn with you, because I think that I can take a little bit of knowledge still in my little head, and try to use it in the best possible way. I really hope that you enjoy these presentations and that you take the wisdom that I wanted to deliver to you and to you use it for a better life. So Lambert, thank you very much for helping us on this. We are just the enablers of the education. You are the substantive part. You put it together this wonderful panelists today. So now I'm going to leave you with your constituency and with your project. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, just a few words. I'm Lambert Cornell with the Office for Information Technology here at the Secretariat. And just a few words to explain why we're doing this program. I think I'm not saying anything new to you guys when I say that technology is developing at an ever-increasing pace, and it's affecting everything around us. It's going to affect our societies, our countries, children and grandchildren significantly, and of course we're very interested to know whether that effect is going to be a positive effect or a negative effect. And there's so many of these technologies. There's AI, there's robotics, there's blockchain, suddenly people are trading in cryptocurrencies. It's changing everything. There's things happening in the medical fields, gene technology, space technology, all these things. We have, to a certain extent, we have colleagues upstairs in our office who are experts in these things, and we do some projects with that ourselves. But personally, actually, I think it's much more important that the representatives of all the different nations here have a discussion about it and have an understanding of all these technologies, and are able to discuss how we can make this a positive change, how we can leverage each of these technologies to make life better. And in some cases that seems clear, in other cases, like today we're talking about artificial intelligence, which is all very exciting, but it does have some very scary implications as well, and some ethical questions. So that is the kind of discussions that I want to initiate, and I hope it doesn't stay within this room, but that it goes on for the next weeks and months. And from our office, we're always there to help from the substantive side, to either provide expertise, to connect you with experts in our office or in the private sector that we where we have connections, and see how we can leverage this technology. Just a few housekeeping things. We're recording the lectures here, but we're not going to record all the questions and answers, so don't feel restrained in asking questions, because that's not going to be publicly posted. We have two talks today. First a talk on generally the general aspects of artificial intelligence by Carol Lapointe, who is with the Beek Center for Social Impact and Innovation in Georgetown University. And after that, I think our second speaker has arrived, Mr. Sharat Sajdev. He's going to speak on applications of artificial intelligence that relate to well-being, human well-being, and human development. So I'm going to hand over to Kari now for the first. Sorry. We have another introductory note from the office, the OHRLS, the Office for, do I say it correctly?
Okay.
Yes. Susanna, please.
Thank you so much. Very briefly, the office where I come from is the Office of the High Representative for the Least Developed Countries, Landlocked Developing Countries, and Small Island Developing States. I'm not sure how many are represented here, but I hope some. And we would just like to convey our appreciation to UNITAR and OICT for their work they're doing, and of course for doing this very important workshop, which is certainly a very relevant topic for all of us. And I mean, as has been said before, this whole issue of artificial intelligence is of course very important for all of us, but also especially in these poorest countries where the technological and also the digital divide is very large. And thus empowering citizens, government, and companies to use new technologies is really a very important thing to do. And we believe that our task lies in making this knowledge available to everyone to unleash the potential of creativity and initiative of the people in the countries and the communities we serve. I just wanted to briefly mention one aspect of things we are doing at our level. As probably some of you are aware, we have been supporting the operationalization of a technology bank for the least developed countries, and which is hopefully going to support the spread of science, technology, and innovation to support the implementation of the SDGs in the LDCs. And we would like to convey our great appreciation also to OICT for supporting this and providing contributions logistically and substantively to make this happen. Just a few words on this technology bank is going to be hosted in Turkey, and as you might know, it marks the achievement of the first SDG target, which is 17.8, and has especially exactly this purpose to tackle this divide of access to science, technology, and capacity to innovate. And this year, we now have a work plan and a budget, and we will start implementation of activities in several pilot countries focusing on technology needs assessment and digital access to research. And I hope to learn something here as well. And thank you so much again for organizing this important training.
Well, good morning. As Lambert said, my name is Carol Point, and I'm here from Georgetown University. I'm a senior fellow at the Beck Center for Social Impact and Innovation. I actually just retired from over 20 years in the United States Navy, where I was primarily an engineer working on autonomous systems for the Navy. But everything comes full circle. I actually started my career in the social impact space. I was living down in the South Pacific in a small island nation, looking how the introduction of a novel technology was destroying their fisheries regimes. That novel technology was motorboats at the time, and we've come a long way, and I've worked on a lot of different technologies, but I've spent a career looking at how different technologies can disrupt systems and how societies and organizations can begin to adapt and understand how to mitigate the negative consequences of technology and take advantage of the positive parts of technology. So that's really why I'm here, to talk about artificial intelligence, and I'll also weave in some autonomous systems. So I just want to start out with a little bit of a poll. So who feels pretty confident about artificial intelligence? I know this is for people who don't feel confident about it, but okay. Who is absolutely terrified when they hear the word artificial intelligence? Nobody? Okay. Who is really excited about artificial intelligence? Well, that's good, that's good. You know, often I walk into rooms and people are much more on the terrified end of the spectrum than the really excited end of the spectrum. But my goal here today is to talk about artificial intelligence in a way that you can connect with it viscerally and really understand it. There's a lot of jargon, there are a lot of words that are really big and complex, and I'm sure that some people who give talks on artificial intelligence say the big words just so that they sound really intelligent saying the big words. But what I really want to do is create an understanding of what it really is and what it isn't, what it's good for, and kind of where you need to be careful about it. So I do encourage you at any point along the way, I'm here to help create understanding, so if anything I'm saying doesn't make sense, please raise your hand and let me know so we can make sure we're getting where we need to go. So what is artificial intelligence? I will start out by saying that there really is not a common accepted definition of what artificial intelligence is. You know, there's a lot of definitions out there, and some of them are very much respected, but there's a lot of different definitions. So I went to the old standby, the dictionary, right? Artificial intelligence, an important a working definition, because there are all these different accepted definitions. But really the capability of a machine to imitate intelligent human behavior, okay? You can't really talk about artificial intelligence without talking a little bit about the history. So some of you may have seen the movie The Imitation Game that came out a couple years ago. It was about Alan Turing, who was a brilliant young man who lived at the beginning of the 20th century and in England. And when he was a student at Cambridge, he actually came up with something called the Universal Turing Machine. It basically was a system that can, a machine could sort through symbols, find what it was looking for, create new symbols. Well, that is the precursor to the modern computer, right? So we did that as a student at Georgetown University, Cambridge University. And then later, when he was working, in World War II, he was doing code breaking in World War II, he came up with something called the Turing test. You may have heard about this, because people who talk about artificial intelligence talk about this a lot. Basically, all the Turing test is if you have a person who is testing blindly a person and a machine, and they can't tell who's who in terms of giving the answer, and they're testing them as hard as they can possibly test them and ask them anything they want to ask, if the machine can fool the tester, it's truly artificial intelligence. It's a truly intelligent machine. So when people talk about the Turing test, that's what it is, right? So people often use that as kind of a litmus test or a yardstick for artificial intelligence. So that's something you'll hear a lot. But so, what does this all really mean? What is artificial intelligence and why do you care about it and how can you use it? So the way I like to think about it is, you hear about robots all the time, right? I'm sorry, I can't see the screen, but so robotics, think of robotics as a machine that's replacing physical motion, right? You've all seen kind of the pictures of robotic arms, other types of robots, they're replacing physical motion. Well, think about artificial intelligence as replacing cognitive action, thought action. So what does that really mean? Wait, I like to think about it as something called the OODA loop, right? Observe, orient, decide, and act. So what this is a way of looking at basically how you go through the world. So if I want to get out of this room, I want to walk out of the room, what am I first going to do? I am going to look around. Maybe the lights are off. Maybe there's some kind of emergency, the lights are off. Maybe, so what do I have to do? I have to feel, I have to listen, right? Maybe there's a fire, maybe I have to smell. But I'm using my senses to take in data about the world. That's observing, right? Then I have to orient. What does that mean? That just means understand. Once I look around the room, I understand that I can't walk straight through this desk. I'm gonna have to walk around, right? I start to understand the layout of the room. Once again, if I didn't have visual, I could use my other sensors to start to make sense of that data, to start to turn that data into what I like to call usable information, right? And then because I have a goal, I want to walk out that room, I have a goal or a mission. So then I will decide, given what I have observed, given what I have understood from what I've observed, I will decide on the action that will get me to achieving that goal, achieving that mission. And then the final piece is I'm going to act. I'm going to stand up and go walk out the room. So that's all this is, right? The observe, orient, decide, and act. Well, computers are doing this too. This is what they're replacing. This is cognitive function and physical function right here. So when you start to think about artificial intelligence, you know, I've bolded the first three there because that's what a machine is doing. It is taking in data. Whether it's a self-driving car and it has different sensors on it, it's taking in data about the world. Whether it's somebody's putting data into a spreadsheet and gonna feed it into an artificial intelligence algorithm. It's just taking lots and lots of data. And then say, okay, what can I understand about that data? How can I orient myself when it comes to that data and start to make connections? And this is why it's really exciting, because computers can go way beyond the human comprehension in terms of points of data that they can understand, right? And then it can make some decisions. And then autonomous systems, which also sound terrifying to some people, right? You know, what are those autonomous systems? You know, you add the act, right? Then they're actually physically acting on that usable information. That's all we're talking about. That's what artificial intelligence and autonomous systems are. Things that observe the world through data. They understand, they create some kind of correlation of data. They recognize patterns in data. They start to turn that into usable information. They decide how they're going to use that to achieve some kind of goal, whatever that goal is. And then they act on it. That's all this is. So here's an example, right? So getting here from Penn Station. I love Google Maps. Or you know, any of the other mapping algorithms out there, Waze is great. I live in DC and we have long commutes, so it's really great to know exactly what's going on with the traffic and what's the fastest way I'm gonna get to Georgetown from out in Annapolis, right? So what is creating the information that you're seeing in one of these maps? How can it be so precise? I have a long commute, and I would tell you that the mapping software I use is pretty accurate, down to a minute or 2 minutes. For a long commute across a big city. That's amazing, right? It's not just taking some kind of information and pumping it out without doing something to kind of understand that data. It's not just taking the data and giving it to me. It's actually taking that data and figuring out a lot of correlations based on prior experience, because artificial intelligence gets smarter. It learns how to do these correlations better, and it's turning that into useful information that it gives me. So in the top case, okay, there's taxis. So, you know, somebody who is, a person who is driving a car, they're taking that output from those artificial intelligence algorithms, which sound really scary, but when you just say, hey, they're taking output from Google Maps or Waze, right? And then they are using that to take action. They're driving through the city. They're gonna go on that route. And maybe a human doesn't have to follow it exactly. I usually don't follow my mapping algorithms exactly. I usually use a little bit of judgment if I hear something on the news that an accident just happened or something. But then the other way this information can be used is an autonomous system. So that's what you have on the bottom. That's Waymo, right? That's the Google self-driving cars. So in that case, a physical machine is taking that information that was given to it from an artificial intelligence algorithm, and it's acting on it. It is moving through the world. You know, it's obviously not going to use just the mapping algorithm. It has other sensors on board a car. It needs to know, you know, what is around it, the people in front of it, where the road is, where the lines are. So it's taking in a lot of different types of information. It's turning it all into usable information. It's called sensor fusion. That sounds a lot more terrifying than taking a bunch of data and turning it into information. But it's taking all those different things and then it's acting on it. So this is what we're really talking about when we're talking about artificial intelligence and autonomy, right? It's actually much more around you and accessible than sometimes it seems when you're reading some of the articles about artificial intelligence. So how does it work? And I promise I won't go into too much of the lingo, but I just want to kind of go through a little bit and talk about there's different types of intelligence. So if you're talking about artificial intelligence, it helps to kind of think through what is that, right? Learning. You know, learning could be as simple as trial and error. I have little kids. You know, one of my kids was like hitting his head against the wall the other day. okay, why are you doing that? I was like, I don't know, I just wanted to try. So he learned pretty fast he should not do it again, right? He did trial and error to see if that would be a fun thing to do. It was not, so he didn't do it again. He learned, right? Trial and error, he learned. Reasoning, it's creating inference, right? So let's say I'm trying to decide this morning whether or not I need an umbrella walking outside. You know, it's either raining or it's not raining. Can't see outside, but you know, I don't hear any rain. So I don't know for sure whether it's raining or not, but I infer that it's not raining because I don't hear that, right? So kind of creating these inferences from data. Problem solving, right? You know, if you have a discrete problem, figuring out the different ways to kind of use your available data to solve that, whatever your goal, whatever your mission is. Remember, I had that problem earlier, I wanted to just walk out the room. You know, my brain had to think through things. Okay, I know I can't go through here, maybe there's more people that direction, so I'll go that direction, right? So this is the problem solving. And perception. We have senses, right? Well, we talked about them before. You see things, you hear things, you taste things, you smell things, right? You touch things, you feel things. Machines sense in different ways, right? And one of the challenges that we have kind of in the policy and regulation space is that because machines sense in different ways, when we try to create machines to operate in the world of people, they're not optimized necessarily to sense in the way we sense. So think about those cars. When you get to an intersection that has a stoplight, how do you know whether you should go or slow down, or some people would say speed up on the other, or stop, right? How do you know? Because you're visually looking at a light that tells you that. That's because visual is our primary sense as people, right? Do you think that a visual sensor is the optimal way for a car, a machine, to interact with something? No, it's really hard. You know, vision is you know, it's come a long way, especially in the last 20 years, but having a machine taking data visually and turn that into information without error is tough sometimes, especially when you're looking in, when you're operating in pretty complex environments, right? I had a professor up at MIT where I did my PhD who always would show this video of him driving around in Boston, right? On a sunny day, great visibility, right? He works on self-driving car algorithms and great visibility. He's like going over the Mass Ave Bridge, which gets you from Boston to MIT. And you can see the lines on the road and you can see everything else. The next day, it snowed and they paved the road so there's no more lines, right? So he takes a picture and shows it to you. Well, for a computer to understand that two very different images are actually representing the same thing is really hard. For us, it's pretty intuitive, and we understand, oh, they pave the road in the snow, right? I still know which direction to go. But so you can't underestimate kind of what a challenge sometimes perception is in terms of perception for intelligence. And then language understanding, right? One of the really exciting things about AI that I have seen is how many algorithms there are out there now that can help with language understanding. That could be anything from that self-driving car understanding the traffic signs around it, that's a language that's understanding. Or, I mean, this is the UN, how many different languages are spoken here? Have you guys used Google Translator, right? I haven't used it, but apparently now you can have it in your ear, and so while you're talking to somebody, it will translate as you're talking to somebody. I have not tried this, but I've heard of this. That's pretty impressive in terms of opening up possibilities to communicate with people that you could never communicate with real time before, right? So these are the different types of things that are intelligence that people are trying to replicate with computers in artificial intelligence. So I just throw this up there, not so anybody looks at any of the titles of movies, but just to show you, there's a lot of different ways to do this. There's lots of different algorithms, and there's really exciting research on all these different ways to do all these different types of intelligence with machines that we just talked about, right? And I'm an engineer. And I talk to groups all the time, and I always say, I have never found a problem that's truly an engineering problem. Not to say there aren't challenges with engineering, but the amount of resources sometimes we put onto developing new technologies to overcome the technical challenges far outweighs the amount of time and resources that we spend on thinking about, I don't know, how do we evolve the ethical frameworks around technology, or the legal or regulatory frameworks? Or how do we evolve the entire infrastructure, right? How do we evolve the entire ecosystem around that technology? So I think that's why efforts like this today are really important, right? Because that is no less important than developing the technology itself.
And we're in a time in society where technology moves at a fast pace. There's so many examples of where technology has moved way faster than any ability of society to catch up. I mean, think about intellectual property rights in the digital age. Right? It was very simple when the way you went and bought a record was you literally went to the store and bought a record. And you hear stories of artists who, you know, billions of people are listening to their music and they're barely getting paid for it because that intellectual property is just out there and freely copied and shared. That's an example of how, you know, society has a hard time kind of keeping up with technology. So there's lots of effort going on in the technology space, but it's really important to think about the other space. But so along the way of kind of how is it working? So this is a really simple example of machine learning. You've probably heard machine learning a lot, right? It's a machine that's learning. It's getting better as it's starting to kind of take data, turn it into usable connections, right? It's getting better along the way. This is a very simple example. And probably one you've done in your head if you've ever bought or sold a house. Okay, I want to buy a house in a suburb of New York City. I have three kids. I want four bedrooms in the house, or you know, however many. I want three bedrooms. I want it to be 2,000 square feet because we need enough space, right? And which neighborhood? I want to be in a certain neighborhood, right? So you take information, and you in your head could kind of process this, and you know, you've probably been watching the real estate market and figuring out, okay, that. You know, what I want is probably going to cost me, I don't know, I would say $500,000, but this is New York, probably way more than that. But what I want, you have a gut feeling about kind of what it should cost, right? That's you taking data, using your brain to make connections and correlations, and turn it into usable information. Because if a house comes up on the market that you really like, but it's twice the price that you really think it should be in that neighborhood, you're not going to bid on it, right? If a house comes up that's in that range, you're probably going to bid on it. So humans are very good at doing this, but to a point, right? When you're starting to talk about tens, hundreds, thousands, millions of data points and making these correlations and making sense of all this data, that's where computers are really good. That's why artificial intelligence is really exciting, because it does that and it gets smarter and smarter as it has more data. And there are some challenges with it, but it's pretty exciting. So this is an example of deep learning. You know, that's the other buzzword that they like, deep learning, right? And these are the algorithms that have many, many layers that the machine is going through to start to make those correlations. When you have all these different factors that you're trying to find information in, people have created these deep learning algorithms and this kind of spider web of nodes. It's basically showing you have all this information and kind of you're in multiple steps, many, many, many steps. It's figuring out ways to create these correlations between the data. And once again, what's it doing? It's taking data. It's putting it through the machine of its algorithm, its artificial intelligence, and it's creating usable information. But these deep learning algorithms are great for when you have a lot of information to really start to learn things, right? You know, facial recognition, this visual recognition. We already talked about how hard it is for a machine to kind of visually see, right? So what do you have to do? If you have a picture of a person, you know, that picture is read by the machine and basically in binary. It's understanding kind of the information that's in that picture, and it's starting to make correlations, right? You may have heard the term supervised learning and unsupervised learning. So supervised learning means that you have a data set that you're going to put into an algorithm, right? And you have somebody there that's training the computer. Well, if you have a Facebook account and you've ever tagged, oh yeah, that's a photo of my sister, you are training an artificial intelligence algorithm. You are training it because you're giving it data and you're saying, okay, this picture correlates to this person. And every time you do that, you get smarter and smarter and more able to recognize your sister when photos of your sister pop up, right? That's what we're talking about, right? You guys every day are training data. You didn't even know that you were training artificial intelligence algorithms, and you are, right? So that's what this is all about. So supervised learning is where you have people who are training data, right? Unsupervised algorithms are a type of algorithm where nobody's training it. It's just kind of coming up with correlations. There's some really interesting algorithms in that respect as well, right? And some of the deep learning, you don't have to train it. Like, it is just coming up with the associations on its own, right? So what are the challenges with that? Well, what's the promise? Because there's really exciting applications, and then what are some of the challenges of what we've talked about? So this is, that didn't come up correctly, but this is supposed to say AI is transformational, or transformative, and to show you all the different industries in terms of where AI is being used. This was a great slide that came, Dr. Tang came up with at Intel in terms of all these different applications that it can be used for. There's a lot of really exciting potential. But what are the challenges? Remember we talked a little bit, you're taking all this data, you're inputting data, you're putting it into an algorithm, and something comes out of the other end. You may have heard the term black box. Everybody is really scared about black box algorithms. And what it is it's because a lot of those algorithms, especially the deep learning algorithms, even the person who coded it can't tell you exactly how it's coming up with those correlations. Right? It's coming up with all these different layers of layers of processes that it's using to create correlations. And so we can't even explain how some of those algorithms are working. Right? And so that's why there's this big push to have transparency in algorithms. People don't want a black box, they want a white box so they can see it. Right? They want to understand what's going on inside those algorithms. Right? So this is one of the challenges. Right? Algorithms are not always transparent. But what I would say is that take the time to understand your data. Right? You guys heard of algorithmic bias? That's the other thing people talk about. Like, okay. People used to think, okay, but technology is an other, like there's no bias in it. It's neutral. There's no positive, there's no negative, it's just neutral. Well, you know, that's not true, right? Nothing's ever neutral. There's always unintended consequences of anything, right? And technology writ large is no exception, and artificial intelligence. So, but with AI algorithms, you can take time to really understand what it's doing, right? There was this terrifying article in a Chinese journal a couple years ago talking about how they were using algorithms to identify criminality based on somebody's face, right, their picture. And they basically took all of these photos of people who had been convicted in the Chinese justice system. They ran deep learning algorithms to say, okay, what does a criminal face look like? And then they were taking that information and saying, okay, well then I can look at you and know that there's a 68% probability that you're a criminal, right? Well, think about that for a second. Okay, there's a couple problems with that. One, you know, you're trying to figure out criminality, but you're not measuring criminality. You're measuring people who have been convicted in the criminal justice system, right? So understanding, you know, how that data really applies and doesn't apply, right? I mean, there's inherent bias just in your data right there. And then also taking kind of general population trends and statistics and then applying that to an individual is not a way that's not a valid way to use that data, right? So there are a lot of things you can do, even if you are dealing with algorithms that you can't necessarily see inside that black box. There are a lot of ways that you can really understand your data set, right? You know, the facial recognition algorithms for a long time worked much better on white men than anybody else. Well, if you looked at the population of people who were training it, that was, you know, it kind of reflected the population of people who were training it. So how do you overcome that? You purposely give more training data to increase the diversity of the set of training data in there, right? So there are ways to engage with these algorithms and be very thoughtful about, okay, what is it learning from? What's the data set it's learning from? You know, what can I really infer from that data? And so what is it, you know, how can I really use those algorithms? So, and also understand that correlation is not the same as understanding. So what are these machines doing? They're correlating, right? When they are identifying that somebody is your sister based on all those clicks you've done on Facebook and they're creating this better correlation, you know, the computer doesn't necessarily understand that it's your sister. It's recognizing. It's recognizing that, you know, the input was this and this is the output. And that's different than understanding. And it also doesn't identify causation. Think back to what we were just talking about in terms of the Chinese criminal system, right? It's not determining causation. The trouble we get into sometimes with AI is that, just like with any other data sets, people take the outputs of those data sets and they try to kind of overuse or use it in ways that aren't necessarily appropriate for what they're really getting. So if you don't take anything else out from today, please understand be very thoughtful about how you're training these algorithms, what the algorithms are actually giving you. So take time to understand the technology, including its limitations, and then thoughtfully design and apply it.
So, you know, I think this will be just a couple minute preview into the next conversation, but you know, what are some of the ways that AI and autonomous systems can be leveraged for social impact? Because this is the exciting part, right? There's this small group called We Robotics. These guys are fabulous, so you definitely need to look them up if you've never seen them before. And they take autonomous, unmanned aerial vehicles. Sometimes they operate autonomously, sometimes they're remote control, but these unmanned vehicles. And they go into places, and they take lives, right? They take pictures. And they start to use artificial intelligence to process that data and start to identify. You know, can you identify where you're starting to get the environmental impacts of climate change? Right? Remember, I live in South Pacific, very near and dear to my heart, right? You know, in terms of the village I lived in when I was there, we'll probably be underwater before long. Right? So these technologies can help start to build information, usable information, that people can use to create policies. You know, when is it time to resettle a community? That is not an insignificant thing. The village that I had lived in Fiji had been there for hundreds upon hundreds of years. Telling them to resettle may sound really great when you're sitting, you know, in some office in another country saying, oh, of course, you should just resettle because the waters are rising, right? But there's a huge impact on lives. So you want to have really, really good information that you're basing that recommendation on, right? These are the ways that artificial intelligence can give you that better information. It can help you create correlations from all of this data. And this is another one I actually just heard about recently, this traffic ban, fighting human trafficking with AI. So it's an app that, you know, apparently launched in the summer of 2016, and I found a statistic that in less than 2 weeks, more than 50,000 people had signed up for it. And basically it's an app, you go into a hotel room, you take a picture of the hotel room, and you geotag where it is, and people are using that to then correlate hotel rooms with photos they have of victims who are being sex trafficked, right? So that they can find where these people are, right? And start to crack down on this. I mean, these are very real ways that AI can be helpful in so many social good applications. So what are the key takeaways, right? One, I would say there's lots of misinformation about out there about AI and autonomous systems, right? But they're not a panacea, and they shouldn't be terrified. They're a tool. They're technology tools. Just like any other tools, you need to start to understand what they're good for, what they're not good for. You should design them thoughtfully to mitigate any potential negative impacts and to use the positive effects of the technology, right? And the really great thing about AI is it can take massive amounts of data beyond human comprehension and turn that into usable information, right? And autonomous systems are just machines that are using that usable information and taking some action to accomplish a mission. So I'll just finish by saying, you know, take the time to really understand what you're getting from artificial intelligence and understand its limitations and how you can apply it, right? But they're really powerful tools for social impact. So that's all I have. I mean, I don't know if we have any time for questions, but.
To stop the camera so people can ask questions.
Yeah, it was a very great presentation. I'm going to open the floor for questions. Maybe